I'm going to turn the remainder of this to Brother Jones. Brother Stephen Jones, I want you to come up here. I love this beautiful family. Y'all know the Jones family? Amen. It's hard keeping up with the Joneses. And I think right now we're going to dim the lights and we're going to get an update on what God is doing. Now, this is, all of you that grew up in Pentecost, this is a real missionary service. When I was a kid, we'd have missionaries come and they'd bring slide projectors. Anybody remember those slides? I don't even know what that is. We have the slide productions and we would get to see what God is doing. So, this is fresh from the field. We're glad the Joneses are here. So let's enjoy what God is doing on the island of Roatan.
Take care. Man, I'm excited for what God's doing in Roatan, Honduras. Amen? Yeah. Amen. Man, I'm going to say a few things about what's going on there and how it affects my life. But before I start, I want to give honor to where honor is due. I thank you, Pastor Young and Sister Young, for investing in me. This would not be possible without your vision and without your love and your time and your support. Thank you to Brother Boston and Sister Haley for supporting me and really casting the vision for this for me from the very beginning, and to Brother and Sister Jones for allowing me to come and help you guys out and be a part of what's going on there. I count it a privilege and an honor, and I'll take it lightly, and I appreciate it very much. And thank you to my parents for supporting me the whole way, and my family, and to everyone here that has played a role in me being there. I'm excited for what God's doing, and I'm thankful for your help, your love, your support, and I couldn't be done without you guys, so thank you, Jesus. I went to Roatan in September with two purposes in mind. One is for me to personally grow, and then two, to be a help to the church there and help the church grow there. And so I needed to grow, and the church needs to grow. And I showed up there with a few uncomfortable, and it was a culture shock. But I was kind of scared at first. I didn't know what was going to happen in the next few months. But I knew I had to make a connection with the people if I was going to be effective. I didn't want there to be a disconnect between me and the people there. And me being an American and them coming from a total different culture, and me a different culture, there was fear in the back of my mind. Like, how am I going to connect with them? How am I going to reach them? How am I going to be a help? But I remember that the Holy Ghost is what connects us. It doesn't matter what culture you're from. It doesn't matter what background you're from. You look back in Acts chapter 2, there was all different cultures there. And when they spoke in the Holy Ghost, they were speaking in different languages. And so that is the connector between me and them. That is the connector between each of us. We all come from different backgrounds and cultures. And the Holy Ghost is what makes us the same and unifies us under one blood and one name. And that name is Jesus Christ. And so I knew that the Holy Ghost in me had to connect with the Holy Ghost in them. And I had the privilege of speaking to them a couple Wednesday nights ago about culture, not knowing Brother Young was going to speak about culture here the night before. And when Brother Young spoke about Rome and the culture, I watched online. It was just direct confirmation of what God wanted me to speak there. And I talked about how I cannot show up into a Roatan, Honduras, thinking like an American. If I'm going to reach a Honduran community and reach an island that is full of brokenness and hurt and just a mentality of survival, do whatever it takes to survive, because it doesn't matter what my neighbor is going through. If it counts between me and them, I'm going to choose me. And I didn't know how to step in and to reach them like that, because I didn't come from a home like that. We grow up here in America and we have it made. And I know we hear that every time someone comes back, but it's true. God has blessed us as a country. And so it affects our culture and our mentality. And so I spoke to them about the culture, and that the only culture that should take prevalence in our life when it comes to spirituality is the culture of the church. The culture of the church should never merge with the culture of the world. It doesn't matter if you're in Europe or Africa or America or Honduras. The culture of this church should never merge with the culture of the world, because we're humanity and we're flawed and we're unholy and we're unrighteous, and the church has to be separate, has to be righteous and holy, so we can't merge it together, because we'll never be effective in the kingdom. And so I spoke that on my heart, and Brother Young confirmed that to me in his message. And so I went there in a mind that I have to let the Holy Ghost in me take away and push back the culture I'm from America. If I'm going to reach a Honduran community, I have to think like a true Christian. I have to talk like a true Christian. I have to act like a true Christian. There's things that I can't say there because it's offensive that I can say here. There's things that I can't do there that are offensive that I can do here because it's a different culture. And so we have to learn as apostolics to push back the lies that we go through every day physically and get into a spiritual mindset and get into the Holy Ghost, allow the Holy Ghost to move through us to reach people that we could never ever reach before if we didn't have the Holy Ghost. And so I'm thankful to be a part of what's going on in Roatan, Honduras. And if anyone else goes in the future, have the mindset of, I cannot think like an American. I have to think like an apostolic. I cannot think like an American and reach them and lead them. I have to get into the Spirit and get into the Word of God and show them that the law of God is what takes all of us and gives us what's right and wrong. Amen. And so I thank you again, Pastor Young, and everyone here and the Jones family. It was an honor and privilege, and I'm just excited for what's going on in Roatan here. God bless you all.
But all of that was worth the love that the people of Roatan gave to me. My favorite moments had to be driving into the community of Crawfish Rock, and dozens of children just came out of nowhere and swore in my car, yelling, "Teacher Abby's here! Teacher Abby's here!" I learned that giving of yourself until it truly hurt was what missions is all about. One of the days that I was teaching at Crawfish Rock, there was a sixth grade boy named Jameson who was extremely intelligent, but also knew that he was very intelligent. And let's just say that he helped me a lot during that class. After the kids were leaving and they were going to their different classrooms, I said, "Jameson, can I talk to you a second?" And so he came in and I said, "You know, Jameson, you are so smart and you are so special." All of a sudden his eyes started glossing, and I said, "I am so proud of you. You are becoming an excellent student, and I believe in you." Tears started to go down his face, and he hugged me, and I realized that that may have been the only time that someone said that they were proud of him and that they believed in him. It became my personal mission to tell every child that I could that I was proud of them and that I believed in them, and there was a church on that island. So believed in them. I am so thankful for Brother and Sister Jones. They pushed me out of my comfort zone and they helped me develop myself. They modeled excellent leadership. I watched as they struggled through their home being robbed, struggled trying to build a church unlike anything else on the island, and sacrificing family time for people in their church and people not in their church. Through it all, they never lost their love for the people of Roatan. I am so thankful that I was given this opportunity to spend a year in Roatan. I thank my pastor for his missions mindset. I thank my dad for his missions mindset. And I thank everyone in this church who supported me through that time. I know I look back one day, and I can't wait to see the growth and progress that this church has made. You have no clue what's going on. But just like they've all said, Roatan gets your heart. And I think it's no secret that I love Roatan. I love the people in Roatan. I couldn't help but cry watching that presentation, seeing my babies. But the thing that, to me, that I want to tell you guys tonight is I went to Roatan about a month ago, and it was amazing to see the transformation of the first apostolic Pentecostal church of Roatan, because just like we've had bugs in our mouths and we've had some crazy experiences in church before, we'll just leave that there. But When we just went a month ago, we walked into a beautiful building where the presence of God was and where you felt safe and where it felt like we were here, regardless of the fact that we were thousands of miles away and we were in a developing world country and we were in an area that's not the safest place I've ever been to. But you could feel the power of God the minute you stepped up those stairs and started walking that building. And you could feel the prayers and the passion of that pastor and his wife and of the people of Roatan that are just working so hard to bring the gospel to those people. All of the work that the Rock Church and the people here and Hope for Students and then particularly Pastor Steve and Sister Rachel have done is paying off, and it is an amazing thing to see.
Well, my Roatan experience was kind of like this, last minute. They just told me last minute that I was speaking, so I have no notes, but my first trip to Roatan went twice, 2 months the first time and 2 months the next time, but the first one was I found out on Tuesday that I was staying for 2 months, and I was leaving that Friday. So I was broke. I went there with no money, but and just like the second time, they basically paid for everything. But I thank you for everyone who supported me and did all my GoFundMe, all the money that you guys gave me. I thank you so much for that. I learned so much with Roatan. I went there thinking, you know, I'm going to show them love. I'm going to see how it's broken. I'm going to try to do what I can. But I went there and they show you love. They show you what true love is. Because they have nothing. You have everything. And it makes you just want to give everything you have just to them. Because they are so happy with nothing. They're running around barefoot, barely any clothes. And then you're saying, oh, I'm hungry. And they're like, oh, I haven't eaten for 3 days. Like, okay, I'm not hungry anymore. So, it's a crazy experience. You learn how to get comfortable with the uncomfortable. And I love my experiences 2 years ago, and I went there not knowing what I wanted to be, what did I want to do, and that whole Roatan experience opened my mind up to what I wanted to do. It opened my career up, which is aviation now. And I believe that if I didn't go to Roatan, those doors wouldn't have been opened. So I just want to thank the Joneses, my pastor, everyone that helped me to let me go to Roatan.
I'm so proud of this group right here because all of them have spent so much time with us, and they have grown so much, and I just want to say I'm really proud of you all. Really proud. Many are called, but few are chosen. Chosen to go, chosen to do, chosen to create. You fill in the blank. This church and this ministry, we have been chosen. Tonight is about reminiscing. It's about looking back and seeing all of your sacrifice, all of your prayers, and all of your giving, and seeing how it's impacting our world. These people that have received the Holy Ghost and that have been baptized, we're going to see them in heaven one day. You may not know them right now, and you may not know their names, and you may not know how they live or where they live and the circumstances that they have. And I hope one day maybe you get to see all that. But if you don't, you're going to see them in heaven. And that is so beautiful and so amazing. And that's what it means to be part of the kingdom of God, because we're a huge family. And tonight, as I watched the video, it meant more to me watching it with all of you, because I felt like we were just sitting together, big family. And I got emotional because I know each of you know my life story, and you know my husband's story. And you've been there for us. And you've held our hands, and you prayed for us in this altar. And we're all doing this together. This is not about Stephen and I. This is all of us in our mission and what God can do when we work in unity together. I have a few pictures that I wanted to show. You can get those ready. There's a girl named Elena. She's a woman, really, and she was our first new convert when we moved there in January, 2 years ago. And let me just tell you, she came in looking like the world. And all she's ever known is how to dress just the right way, how to walk just the right way. And all of that to get a husband, to get a man, nothing about her future really mattered except for that. And right now, she's in Hope Corps. She's looking for her future, for bigger things, things that really matter. And she told me after Brother Young, you preached something about you, wanting to know about your why. And my husband preached it to our church. And she came to me and she said, my why, Sister Jones, is to serve. And it really struck my heart because this is somebody that has no teaching whatsoever. And God spoke to her and showed her that. And it's beautiful. And yes, that's Elena. And God has so big things in store for her. And the next picture is Helen. And that's her getting baptized. This is a 14-year-old girl who's now 15, but at the time she got baptized when she was 14. She is fatherless. Her dad died when she was really young. And she's motherless because her mother has cancer and has to live on the mainland just to survive. She's in the hospital. And she lives with her sister. And Helen never misses church. She has not missed one service. It doesn't matter if she's sick. It doesn't matter what's going on. She does not miss church. And I just wanted to show you, this is somebody that you're impacting because of your prayers. And she just got the Holy Ghost 2 months ago. So we're so excited about what God's doing in her life. You can go to the next slide. This is Sania and Genesis. About 6 months ago, I started giving them a Bible study. They are Catholic, raised Catholic. And when I started giving her the Bible study, she was so hungry for God and she had so many questions. And I took my time because I really wanted to make sure that it really got into, that the seed in the ground really was ready. And when I got to the baptism part, she looked at me and she said, Sister Jones, why are you going so slow? And I said, because I want to make sure you really understand. She says, I understand. Está claro, está claro. She said, I need to get baptized right now. I said, okay, let's do this. And she was baptized with her daughter. This picture was taken a month ago. So this is brand new stuff. We're seeing young ladies that were raised, all they ever knew was get a man, have a baby. That was it. No other goals in life. And those are great things. But we know, because we're taught all the time, that we have worth and that we have beautiful things that God has for us and a purpose. And now we're able to take these young ladies and teach them and show them that God has something for you and you have worth and you have a purpose. And we're watching these young men and old men be converted and be delivered. And it's just exciting. And I just wanted to tell you all tonight these things because I want you to leave refreshed. I want you to leave full of faith as we go into the holidays, as we celebrate Christmas, as we move into 2019. And looking back, we all have struggles this year. We've all had things that have been negative. But let's move forward. Let's go into the greatest year of our life. 2019 can be the greatest year of your life if you will really decide for that to happen. I love this church. I love my pastor so much. And I love my pastor's wife so much. I would be nothing without them. And I love Bishop and Sister Wilson. I would be nothing without them. And if I was not in Honduras, this is where I would be, helping to facilitate the revival that's happening in Sacramento. Because there is no greater church on the planet. There is no greater church than this place. So let's go together. Let's reach the lost. And let's just keep moving forward in Jesus' name.
And then one more time, can we just clap our hands and rejoice? all the wonderful things that God is doing. I would be totally satisfied if this was the end, but I'll speak for just a few moments and then we'll be dismissed. I want to echo the sentiments of my wife and say how amazing it was to be able to watch that video with you guys. Because I didn't realize how many of you had been to Honduras and Roatan and sacrificed until you were all up on the platform together. It really took my breath away to know that Roatan is the culmination of a lot of people sacrificing to see it come to pass. And I want to say how much I appreciate your sacrifice. Many of you, you've come and you've preached and you've taught and you've worked or you've sacrificed or you've sent resources because you couldn't go. And I could not express how thankful I am for you and what that means to the work of God in Honduras. A lot of those testimonies that you saw on the screen and you witnessed are instant miracles. Things that happened immediately. We thank God for that. Some things just take a little bit of time. And thank God for instantaneous, miraculous moves of God. Thank God for the everyday incremental growth that we see. Amen. That's not always visible when you're standing in front of it every day. Like the growth of a toddler. You watch them grow every day. You don't see it. But you step out of their life for 5 years and you're blown away. This has been the work of God in Honduras has been there for 6 years, more or less. And we've seen 300 people baptized in Jesus' name. And that many or more have seen the gift of the Holy Ghost evidenced by speaking in other tongues. It's a beautiful thing. And I want to say how much I appreciate Pastor Young and Sister Young, who are constantly needed here. On a regular church service, I think Brother Young was there on a Wednesday night a few weeks ago, 85 or 90 people in church. 85 or 90 people will demand your attention all week until you just have to tell them, do not call me on Thursdays. Unless there is a knife in your shoulder, and you are on your way to the hospital, do not call me. That doesn't work ever, but we try it. And they are constantly needed here, but they continue to go. And they've got a global vision, and this church helps to facilitate that. Because when they go, this church just continues to function like a world-class operation. And that's amazing to me. When they're gone from here, you miss them, but they're strengthening wherever they are. And I'm thankful when they're in Honduras, strengthening our people. Amen. One of the greatest natural forces in the world and a resource is wind. For thousands of years, people have attempted to understand and visualize and harness the power of wind. We use wind to steer ships, to separate the wheat, the chaff, to collect and distribute water, to fly planes. And while wind can produce good, profitable things, wind has also been the cause of some of the world's greatest natural disasters. Hurricanes destroy cities. Like the 2005 Hurricane Katrina killed 1,200 people. Tornadoes devastate homes like the 2011 Joplin tornado that killed 158 people. Uncontrolled fires in Paradise and in Malibu this year have flattened entire communities. And even winds of ideology, they're not physical winds, but they're a wind of ideology, have wreaked havoc on nations and cultures, as the winds of radical Islam spread through the Middle East and gusted its way to New York City. And there was no physical storm, but
the ideological hurricane crashed into the World Trade Centers and killed over 3,000 people. Since the beginning of time, there was the creation in the presence of wind. Genesis records, the first account says the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the water. One translation says a great wind hovered over the face of the deep. It's our first glimpse at life and creation. And winds have continued to blow for thousands of years. Acts chapter 2 records the event as Pentecostals, we know this so well. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all in one place in one accord. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind. And it filled all the house where they were seated. This was not the first time wind had ever blown across the earth, but it was the first time the wind of the Holy Ghost had ever blown across the earth, and it opened the door for salvation, the Bible says, to whosoever would have it. And a little bit later in Acts chapter number 10, you see where Peter receives a vision from God while praying on a rooftop. The Bible says that he was praying before the food was prepared and he fell into a trance. The Bible says that there was a sheet that descended from heaven, and upon it were all manner of clean and unclean beasts, to which the Lord told Peter, "Rise, Peter, slay and eat." To which Peter replied, "Lord, I cannot eat this because I have never eaten anything that was common or anything that was unclean." The Lord rebuked Peter, and he said, "Do not call unclean that which is clean, and do not call common that which is uncommon." In other words, this is metaphoric concerning an expanding revival. Peter thought that he had the monopoly in the corner on the market, but God said, "Peter, you cannot marginalize the wind, and you cannot harness the wind. You think this wind is just for the Jews, but I'm opening up a door of revival to the Gentiles that you didn't even know was available." And the next time we see Peter, he's preaching to Cornelius, and the Bible says that self-same hour, he baptized Cornelius in the name of Jesus Christ. Let me just go ahead and tell you, at the close of 2018, there are winds of revival that are blowing across this nation, that are blowing across this world, that you didn't even know were blowing, but they are blowing. And let me just tell you, Sacramento doesn't have a corner on the market, because this thing was not done in a corner. Paul told him, "You don't know where this thing came from, and you don't know where this thing's going, but there is a worldwide revival that's fixing to break out of Jerusalem and Samaria and to the uttermost parts of the earth." Let me just go ahead and tell you, 2019 is going to be the greatest year of revival that we've ever seen. You have no idea what God's fixing to do.
Revelation, because the wind blows where it listeth. You don't know where it's blowing.
150,000 people saw that picture right there. That man, it was a criminal, he was a drug addict, he was an abusive person, and that was all before God got a hold of him. Let me show you the next picture. That's the next picture, because Brother Edson got the Holy Ghost, he got baptized in Jesus' name, and now he walks the streets before church with a little megaphone, and he's declaring the goodness of God. Hey, I just showed up to wish you a Merry Christmas and tell you there is revival happening all over the world, and we get to be a part of it. Hallelujah. Oh my goodness. Hey, those are spiritual victories. Let me tell you a victory that may not seem so spiritual. Why y'all sitting down? Just about done. Y'all don't sit down. I know y'all hear that all the time. I'm 25 more minutes. No, I'm serious. I'm almost done. I told Brother Jared this right before church. We bought the material to put the roof on our building, but we didn't have any money to pay anybody to install it. I said, well, I guess I'm going to install it. We got these ceramic tiles, adobe tiles. Some of y'all have them on your house. My parents have them on their house. And I said, man, we need some bids from people to come and install these tiles. I got two bids. One of them was $3,500, U.S. dollars. The other one was $4,200. I said, I don't have $3,500. I don't have $4,200. I barely got $200. And I'm sitting there frustrated because we're having service in the rain. And a motorcycle pulls into the church parking lot. I've never laid eyes on this man before in my life. But he's seen the ceramic tiles in our parking lot. And he said, who's in charge here? He spoke pretty good English. I said, well, I'm in charge. What you want? That intimidated him because I got a big intimidating friend, you know. He said, no, really, who's in charge? I said, me, I'm in charge. Quit messing around. He said, you got somebody to install those tiles? I said, not yet. He said, well, I just got deported from Honduras, or from San Jose, California. He said, I'm a Honduran, I just got deported. He said, I've done these tiles my whole life. He said, they pulled me off of a job and sent me back to Honduras, and I'm looking for work. Can I give you a bid? I said, man, you can give me a bid. He went upstairs. He pulled a couple measurements. He came downstairs. He says, how does $750 sound? I said, praise God, buddy. You got the job. God was telling me, I pay the bills of this church. I'm going to build this church. Even if I got a deport on illegal from San Jose to put your roof on, I'm going to build this building in Jesus' name. At the sea, and I say, God, how am I going to finish this building? And every single time, God says, you're not going to finish this building. I'm going to finish this building. You just keep preaching the truth, and I'll send the people to build it. Hey, I'm just here to tell you, revival's happening. God is on the move. People are getting set free. Drug addicts are getting set free. Marriages are getting put back together. People are getting the Holy Ghost. People are getting baptized. We're starting new churches. 16 new churches on the mainland. In the name of Jesus, come on, would you clap your hands right now and rejoice in what God is doing, what God has done, and what God is going to do.
Hallelujah. No wonder they're having a revival. That man's full of the wind. And it's not just hot air, it's the Holy Ghost.
It's real. It's revival. I was just there about 30 days ago, and it's not pie in the sky. It's not somebody selling you a bill of goods. There is a real apostolic revival church that has been built, not only physically, but spiritually. That's your spiritual grandkids. How many love this family? They're doing an incredible work. Here's what we're going to do. It's Christmas time, and they are building. when I tell you they are building what could possibly be the nicest building on the island. And I know there's resorts. Roatan's an interesting place. There'll be a beautiful resort right next to a tin shack. And you got the filthy rich that come over from Guatemala, the mainland, and they have bought property and they are dominating. And right next to it is people that have nothing. And God has anointed this family, and they are having a revival. And I'm not just giving you verbiage. I'm telling you there is a real apostolic revival that's taking place there. And they are building a building, I think, in three stages. And they are nearing the completion of stage one. And that stage one seats about 100, 120. Now, they cram them in their Honduran style. There's no telling how many they really get in there, but it's a good thing they don't have the fire marshal from Elk Grove there. But they get, I think there was about 100 people or so there the last time I was there. But then phase two is going to seat around 350 to 400, something like that. And then there's stage three. And I want this church, I know we have been a part of this, but this is real. And it's Christmas time, and I felt to have them, they're home for the holidays. And I believe that we could get at least $10,000 tonight in this room to help with this building. I don't think you owe anything other than maybe something that y'all done in the last 30 days. They're not in debt, they're not upside down. They have built this as God has provided. And when God doesn't provide, they stop building. But it's not the will of God for there to be a half-finished building. And I told him, I said, don't you go in debt. You just trust God. This is God helping you. And so God is helping them. And they're here with us. I believe we can give at least $10,000. We're going to give them a personal offering as well. So we're going to give you our personal offering. But I believe we can give $10,000 at least. And I'll tell you what, if $50,000 comes in, we're giving all $50,000. Whatever comes in tonight, we're going to give. I want us to be, this is your kids. They got the Holy Ghost in these altars. They were baptized in these baptistries. You were their Sunday school teachers. You were their school teachers, their PE teachers, their boys club coaches, and Girls for God and everything else they went through. That's your kids. And they're doing it. These are people that are a trophy of what you have produced. And this is a testimony. So, somebody here, you may can write a check for $10,000 on one person. Maybe you can't. Maybe you can give $500. Maybe you've got $50. You got $5. It doesn't matter what it is. But I believe that we can make a significant contribution to the work in Roatan. Brethren, just put the offering plates out there. And if you're a guest tonight, you're welcome to give. This is a real thing. Hey, understand something. There's a lot going on in the natural. A lot going on. You know the events that have been on our border with the caravan and the majority of those people. In fact, a large number of that caravan was from the island of Roatan. That's what I've been told. Honduras, because of the violence and the severity on that island and on that mainland and the challenges that are there. But let me just tell you something. All of that upheaval in the natural is a sign that the Spirit is stirred up. I know it's a little Christmas time and we're not really in a deep, real spiritual mood right now. But I want you to know something. There's a principle in the Word of God. You see in the natural what is happening in the spiritual. And so all of the upheaval in the natural that we're seeing in the political front, understand behind all of that, there's a very real spiritual thing going on. And I believe that there are people that are searching for answers that God has anointed this family to bring the gospel to. And I believe we can have a direct connection to helping build that church and get it done so that they can have real. There are many, 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 many business people that have watched the effort of this couple. I was there 30 days ago doing interviews for my doctoral program. And while I was there, I was talking to business people in the community. And when they found out, they said, are you with Pastor Stephen? I said, yeah. They said, man, we can't wait for that church to get built because that's going to be our church. And there's people that are saying that, but they could fund missions all by themselves. There's no telling what God's going to do on that island through this couple. And we can sow a seed. So we're going to give in faith. I want you to bow your head. God, I ask you right now, touch the heart of men and women. You have blessed us. You have given us riches and wealth. God, I know maybe we don't feel wealthy, but compared to the people that are in this world, we have been so blessed. And God, I pray that right now there would be a spirit of giving that touches this church. You're doing a mighty work on that island. You started it with this church. God, we're going to be faithful to complete that vision as you bless us. And God, I know that someone's going to give in this offer tonight, and they're going to be rewarded in the next number of weeks because they sacrificed. I pray a blessing upon the gift and the giver of life right now. Amen. Brother Brian, just play something and bring your offering right now. This is a Christmas offering. We're going to give a gift.